Welcome and thank you for joining us for the Word of Life midweek message. Are you ready to be encouraged, to experience growth in your walk with Christ, and to pursue all that God has for you? Then grab a pen, open your heart, and get ready to hear this week's message. You can find us online, follow us on Twitter and Facebook, and remember to log in each week for a new eChurch message.
God, welcome everyone to Word of Life's midweek service. We're excited to have you with us again tonight. We've been discussing the last several weeks on the topic of what we call faith keys. Jesus said, "Behold, I give you the keys to the kingdom. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." And so our words, we are in control of what heaven is going to give us. You say, well, God is sovereign. He'll do what he wants. Well, God has a sovereignty about him. There's no question about it, but he's made covenant with man. And God has given man authority. And God has given a man free will. And God has given a man the power to choose life and death. Amen. I love the scripture that says, I set before you blessing and cursing, life and death. Choose life. I love that. God says, I give you the choice, but I'm going to tell you which one to choose for your good, for your benefit. Praise God. Let's have a word of prayer. I already feel the anointing of God begin to rise upon me. Hallelujah. It's an amazing thing when I step behind this camera and these lights come on. The Spirit of God, it's without fail every single time he comes upon me. You know, it has nothing to do with me. And you know, I used to think people were just trying to have a false humility when they said that. But when you could see the preparation that it takes to preach a sermon and to study and to pray and all the lights and the cameras and the work that goes in behind the scenes, there's such a, you feel so dry. And yet when those lights come on and the camera comes on and the microphone is turned on, all of a sudden, when I step on this pulpit to preach, there's a presence that comes upon me and rises up, hallelujah, within me, hallelujah. We know that Jesus said, you shall receive the Holy Ghost. And when I'm taken away, he goes, oh, my Father will send another comforter. The word another means one just like the other. And the Holy Spirit is exactly what you see Jesus doing. The Holy Spirit will do to us and do through us. We're not greater than Jesus. We're not declaring that we are, but Jesus has given us the right to use his name. Hallelujah. When we use in Jesus' name, we're using the power of attorney that a perfect God, an almighty God, a perfect person who never committed one sin has given us the right, the privilege, and the authority to use his name. Glory be to God. What a privileged people we really are. That's what the Bible calls us. We're a peculiar people, a holy nation, a royal priesthood. Oh, it's beautiful. You're a royal priest, my brothers and sisters. You're a part of a holy nation, not because of anything you've done, but what Jesus, his precious blood, has done on your behalf and our behalf. Glory to God. Father, tonight we just worship you. Glory to God. Oh, I feel your presence, Father. We thank you for that presence. For the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, Father, because you have anointed me to preach this gospel to people who are poor in spirit. And I thank you that the anointing of God flows freely tonight. And the people have ears to hear what the Spirit of the Lord would say unto them. That they have a receptive heart. Lord, let things that they need to know pop out to them. That they prick their heart, Father God, with the things that minister grace and life to them. We thank you for the unction and the Holy Spirit tonight, Father. And I just release glory to God. I just feel the Spirit of peace. Usually it's like a river rising within me. But the Bible says he'll lead us beside still waters. Glory to God. And the anointing of God, I love it when the Spirit of God comes upon me and David said, by thee, O God, I've run through a troop and leaped over a wall. And we love that spirit of might that comes upon us, that came upon Samson, the spirit of might that came upon David, and he broke a bow, a steel bow with his bare hands. We love that anointing, and that feel the raw authority, the raw power of God. But there's another side to the Father, hallelujah. And it's the peace of God, glory to God, that passes all understanding. This is what I love about it, because when you talk about your personality, people begin, you can, it's like actors, you get pigeonholed. You know, a certain actor will do, you know, some funny films and Jim Carrey and Adam Sandler, different comedians, they do these such funny little goofy kind of movies when they're younger. And when they get older, they don't want to be pigeonholed as just a goofball comedian. And they wanted to do more serious parts, and people won't almost allow them to do different parts because they've got them. They got this is the way it's got to be because you do funny movies, And though they don't mind doing funny movies, and that's exactly how they made their name, they want to expand and they want to show a different side of them that oftentimes people don't appreciate and don't immediately grab hold of. I want you to know the Holy Spirit is more than power. The Holy Spirit is love. If God is love and Jesus is God and the Holy Spirit is God, then the Holy Spirit is love. The Holy Spirit is called the peace of God that passes all understanding. He's called the Comforter. Hallelujah. He's not just the one that comes with power and might. He's the one that comes with comfort. And tonight as I minister to you, the Spirit of might is not upon me, but the Spirit of the Comforter is. Hallelujah. So may the word of the Lord find free course in you tonight. And may this other side of God, the other side of the coin, the other side of the pillow, if you will, the cool side of the pillow. As we flip that pillow over, and I get up in the middle of the night and I always flip my pillow over so I get the cool side of the pillow. And I find the coolness to be refreshing to my head. And the Holy Spirit brings that fire of the Holy Ghost, but he also brings that, bring you beside the still waters. Hallelujah. Be still and know that I am God. Glory to God. You see, my brothers and sisters, I feel the anointing of God just as strong upon me right now as I do when it rages through me like a volcano, like an earthquake. And while and people think, well, that's his personality. He's a real zealous guy. And the fact of the matter is I'm really not that zealous. It's just when the anointing of God comes upon me, the Spirit of God's zealous. Hallelujah. Now, when I was younger, I had a lot more zeal than I do now. But because when you're a pastor, you have to, and you end up being a grandfather, you get tempered a little bit. I think we get tempered as we get a little bit older, don't we? Or at least we should be. And so I like that other side. And I want you to know that I'm just as comfortable with the Holy Spirit coming upon me to do these things and to speak with a comfort as I am when he's like the whitewater rapids and he's just shooting you down the river. I found that God is God, whether he's manifesting in power or manifesting in peace. So just receive. You see, when I go pray and I seek the face of God in the morning, and I've tried to make that my habit since 1981, and where I would go, you know, come aside and be with the Lord by myself and try to spend some good quality time with him. What I've learned over the years is that God would come to me in a certain way, and I would just love the way he would come because he came in power and authority. And then as time went on, I began to experience him in a different light. And though it was different and it didn't bring the same kind of, where you just want to run up on a mountaintop, it brought such a peace and a comfort. And I found that it's still God, even though it may not be the way that I want it to be. I've always found that the Lord he's the one that's in control of the prayer time. And I didn't understand it for years. Like, what's wrong with me? How come I was so explosive yesterday and today is just kind of like it's meager in comparison to yesterday? But I feel peace and I feel his grace and I feel his presence, but it's not as explosive as it was. Folks, pastors don't contain that. We're not the ones that decide when to hit the switch. And guys that do that, women that do that, you know, they usually don't make it very long in the ministry because you can see through it. Nobody has that on switch. You're not in harvest mode all the time. There's a time to sow. There's a time to water. And then there's a time when you harvest and God gives the increase. And so we love that time when the sickle is put in. We love that. But there's also the raining time. And there's the seed time. And that rain time is when the presence of God comes, but it's not explosive, but he's always there. And sometimes when the seed time, the season may be a little drier, a little quieter, so that we can receive the engrafted word with meekness. To receive the word is to receive the seed. Amen. When that thrusting harvest power comes, that's the sickle going into the full ear, in the full corn in the ear. And it's explosive, but you're not in harvest all the time. And that'll explain your prayer time, like why you feel explosion sometimes. And sometimes you feel like, well, I feel his presence, but it's not as explosive as I want it to be. That's you're in the rain season. Well, you feel his presence, but you're not in harvest. Just continue to speak the word. We're going to talk about that. But what about when the clouds are there and the wind's blowing hard and you don't feel God and you don't see God and you don't feel the power of God and then you're faced with, well, am I going to make confessions and in my prayer, or that my prayers going to be predicated upon what I feel, or are they going to be predicated upon what I believe? Glory to God. Oh, praise God. So tonight we want to talk to you about speaking in the dark. The Holy Spirit has really begun to put this strong in my heart, and I'm finding that I've taught on faith for many years, but this is this. I tell you, we're coming full circle, aren't we? Daniel said, "In the last days, knowledge shall be increased." We're smarter than we were a few years ago. God's taught us more. He's refined our faith. Hallelujah. He's given us more understanding as time's gone on. And some of the things we used to believe when we were younger, we kind of scratch our head going, man, I was a little bit radical in that, but now I have a little bit better understanding. Well, of course. Paul said, when I was a child, I spake like a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. So we're becoming a man of God. We're becoming mature in God. Hallelujah. And our faith is increasing. Hallelujah. And we're getting, we're maybe not have as much outward zeal, but there's an inward calm. And I'll tell you this, when it's time, glory to God, to put the sickle into the harvest, I'll tell you, the Spirit of God will rise up within you just as strong as He ever did. But you're going to learn how to cooperate with the Holy Spirit during the different seed time, rain time, and harvest time. And if we don't cooperate with Him, then we're going to be the man that we're going to talk about here in a minute, the double-minded man who's unstable in all of his ways. Because if God's not moving and they're not shaking and they're not feeling something, and the glory of God's not filling the tabernacle, and the Spirit of God's not moving upon the preacher, and they're not prophesying every 5 minutes, and they're not giving a word for everybody in every 5 minutes, and they don't, and the church isn't growing, exploding out the doors like they want it to, and the worship's not what they want, and the preacher's wife's not what they want, and the piano player's not what they want, and the guitar player's not any good, and the singers aren't anointed, and the preacher's not anointed, and how come it's not like it used to be? And you're going to keep asking those questions, and you're not going to get anything from God. And all you're going to have is a sorry disposition, a defeated life, and a bitter aptitude and a bitter disposition concerning your life. And so it's time for us to learn, and I'm going to share some things. I think a lot of times we're just frustrated because we don't have understanding. And we're told in the Word of God, with all thy getting, get understanding. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. And the word for hearing is the word understanding what has been heard. So we need to give. You really can't have faith until you hear something or understand what you've heard. You may not know how it operates, but you understand that this is the system that God set up. With that being said, I want you to turn in your Bibles to James tonight. James chapter 1. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. Boy, I feel the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Oh, glory to God. Praise the name of Jesus. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now that Holy Spirit just shifted gears. Praise God. I love this because the atmosphere changes. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. James chapter 1, if you look at verse 6, hallelujah, verse 5. If any of you, talking to Christians, lack wisdom, let him ask of God that gives to all men liberally. And he upbraids not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith. Let him ask in faith. What does it mean to ask in faith? But let him ask in faith. I love that scripture. Verse 6, but let him ask in faith. And that's what the Holy Spirit is saying to us. But, because you can talk to God, you can ask God, you can speak to the mountain. But, this is a conjunction. But, here comes the condition. But, yet, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. Now that right there is where the battle is won and lost right there. The battle is won and lost with the man's mind and heart that begins to waver, to vacillate backwards and back and forth because of what he sees or what he doesn't see. Well, if it's not working, I prayed. I talked to a person one time. They said, "Well, my husband's not treating me right," I said, "Well, have you been interceding for him? Been praying for him?" Well, I prayed about it for 2 days, but if they're not going, you know, God didn't do anything. Let's understand this. James says that Jesus has long patience, waiting for the precious fruit of the earth. You know how long he's been waiting for this final harvest? 2,000 years. Jesus is waiting with long patience, waiting for the precious fruit of the earth, but you can't wait more than 2 days for the precious fruit of your marriage. I mean, how bad do you really want that to work? Well, I'll try that faith stuff and see if it works. And I prayed. I took a stab at it. Some of it, we just take a shotgun with pellets and just start firing towards heaven. Hope some of it sticks. Hope we hit something. You don't need to take a shotgun and start firing to heaven hoping that a pellet or two hits God. Well, I said about 1,000 prayers up there. Maybe one of them will get answered. I just put one single, just put one bullet in my gun and put a scope on there. That scope is, that brings a pure definition from a law. What's the scope do? It brings that animal, it brings that person. If you're a sniper, it brings the enemy into sight. Now we've seen that a guy could be shot from over a mile. One guy got shot from 2 miles away. A Canadian sniper killed a man from 2 miles away. So it's the record. So 2 miles away, you can't see something 2 miles away, but with that scope on that gun, it brings that thing, that image that you're looking at, brings it a lot closer to you. You just pull that trigger and it's like he's standing right next to you. Not killed him deader than 4 o'clock in the morning. Hallelujah. Okay. So our, those are my old Kentucky sayings. Amen. And so we can put the word of God, the promise of God is like ammunition, and we're not fighting God, so don't send me any emails. But I'm talking about making a connection with God, getting that scope, looking through that scope to where we can see the invisible God that's living billions of miles away, but we can see his heart and his mind, because with all due respect, he lives in our heart by faith. So it's not like I'm using it as an analogy, like the person of God is in heaven. Jesus is at his right hand making intercession and preparing a place for us. They're in a literal place called heaven. But the Spirit of God dwells in our heart by faith. So when I say we don't have to look up to heaven and talk to the God in heaven, he's in here. But sometimes we need to bring heavens, we need to look at through the scope, the telescope or that gun scope. We're going to need to look through that scope and see and bring heaven closer to our heart to where it's not something so far away we can understand it, but it's something that we can grasp. It's like it's right in front of our eyes. And that image can be a long way away, but that scope brings it right up to your eyeball to where you can see the color of their eyes. Amen. And so that's what the Word of God does. The Holy Spirit brings that. He brings that Word into view, into focus, to where you can see it, you can understand it, and make it out. Hallelujah. Where you can discern what is the enemy and what is God, what is flesh and what is spirit. Hallelujah. And that's what we want the Holy Spirit to do. And this is what I want the Holy Spirit to do through my preaching tonight, is that Him for rightly divide the Word of truth, to where when you hear the Word of God, that you're able to take religious tradition that you just did it because your pappy did it and your mama did it and your grandmama did it, and you start seeing it for yourself, and you have conviction and you have faith in what God has shown you, and not just you say, well, one guy told me, he goes, well, I'm a Presbyterian. I said, so that's good. And I didn't have to ask any questions. We're just as watching him. Our sons were playing basketball. He goes, well, I'm Presbyterian. My daddy is Presbyterian, and I'm going to be Presbyterian. My grandpa's Presbyterian, and that's what I'm going to be. I'm like, okay. My wife, when I met her grandpa worked for Ford. So grandpa had a Ford. Daddy had a Ford. And, of course, when daddy got my wife a car, she said it had to be a Ford. They're Ford people. If you drove up in a Chevrolet, they would have thought something, they would have died and gone to hell. Well, that's just because they work for the company, and that tradition's passed on down. I wasn't raised driving Fords. Hallelujah. So I've owned a few in my life, but I just find out whatever I like and whatever I can afford, and I go for it. Amen. But some people are so locked in to being Baptists and Methodists, and they're so locked in to being the Word. And is this guy preaching the Word? If you're preaching the Bible, you're preaching the Word. And you're not just the Word people aren't only just in Word churches. Well, we're the Word church. Well, every church is a Word church, and I know what you're trying to say, and I fall more into that category. I believe in it, but I also believe in the power of the Holy Spirit and the sovereignty of God, and we need to learn how to flow with the Spirit, and we need to learn how to flow or how to operate when the Spirit of God's not seemingly moving on our behalf. And that's what this whole sermon's about tonight. And this just takes skill. This is where the Word churches, this is where they understood this. And sometimes I've been in a lot of them, and there sometimes not a great flow of the Holy Spirit. And then I've been in a lot of the charismatic churches where the Spirit of God flows, but there's not a lot of understanding of what to do when the Word of God's not spoken, when the Spirit of God's not moving, or should I say, yeah, when the Spirit of God's not manifesting itself. Sometimes they don't know what to do because everything's got to be by the Holy Ghost. What happens when you wake up in the morning and the Spirit of God's not on your prayer time like He usually does? What are you going to do? Well, something's wrong, something's wrong, something's wrong. And you start confessing something wrong. The Bible says that you're a double-minded man. Just because you're not feeling what you felt yesterday doesn't mean something wrong. It could be something's right, and God's beginning to teach you how to hear Him in the still small voice. If you'll understand that God worked backwards with Elijah. Elijah was known as, when Elijah came on the scene, they were always talking about, where's the God of Elijah? The God that answers by fire. And at the very end of Elijah's ministry, God started teaching him about the still small voice. So God showed up with power and glory in the early part of his ministry, but God wasn't showing up in the earthquakes and the lightnings and the fires and the shaking, and God wasn't showing up in it. But God showed up with him in the still small voice. So God was teaching him something, wasn't he? He may have attracted him, glory to God, with a burning bush, with Moses had the burning bush, but then Moses learned to hear the voice of God. At first, God will use things to attract you, but it doesn't have to be. Moses didn't dig the bush up, strap it to his back, and carry it around with him for the next 80 years. No, he pulled aside, saw the great sight, and he didn't know God was in the bush. He saw a bush that was on fire, and he went over there, and he was blown away because it wasn't consumed, yet it was on fire. He says, let's set aside and see this great sight. He didn't know it was God. As he drew closer, God was using something outward to draw his attention, but then God used the word of God for the next 80 years in his life. And so just because you had an experience with God doesn't mean that God doesn't want you. Well, we're the experienced people. Well, we're the word people. God wants you to have experiences, and God wants you to have the word. But if you're going to have one or the other, choose the word. Because the man that has the word, signs will follow that. But the man that has experiences, the word doesn't follow experiences. But the experiences follow the word. So if you have to choose, don't be dismayed if you're not feeling God. It's God's way of saying, I'm going to let the roots go down deeper. You see, when it seems to be dry, the tree roots, they go down deep into the earth, and they're looking for water. They are searching for water. They'll go sideways, and they'll go down as deep because they're looking. They're dying. They've got to have that nourishment. So they'll go down deep and want to get established. And God uses the dry time to establish the root system. When you live in the swampy areas, the tree roots don't go down deep because they're planted next to sometimes in the waters, in the swamps. And so the trees, the hurricane winds come along and they blow them right over. Why? Because they don't have a deep root system. So the winds of adversity that come, because it's always planted by the water or always feeling God, always feeling the Holy Spirit. So if you don't feel him, and I really believe this is why a lot of Pentecostal churches and a lot of charismatic churches have dried up. Because when the season of the charismatic movement was over, it's like they didn't know what to do. And I got news for you. The word is God. In the beginning was the word. Wasn't the experience. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Then it says the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So let's learn to speak the Word. And so when we're not feeling anything, this is the perfect opportunity for the tree root to go down deep searching for water. And if it doesn't find any water, it will find water eventually. But just let it keep on going. And don't you give up, because every day that it's dry, the root is going deeper and deeper and deeper. What's happening? It's looking for, I'm not finding water, preacher. You don't have to find the water. It'll find you. Seek and you will find. But what will happen is by the time it comes to you, your root system will be so established, so rooted and grounded and established in the faith that the winds of adversity begin to come. You will laugh in the voice, in the face of adversity. That when the fierce winds come, you will laugh at them because your roots have been rooted and grounded and established in what? The faith. Hallelujah. Amen. Verse 6 says, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavers is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. He that wavers is like a wave of the sea. Now, as I was studying this, the Holy Spirit showed this. And I heard this on the inside of me, so I wrote it down. First of all, let me establish to you what is asking in faith. Asking in faith is this. It's when you can ask God something with confidence. Well, how can you have confidence? You're either going to have confidence because you feel God. Okay, what happens if you don't feel God and you're praying? It says this, and 1 John says, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will or his word, same thing, if we ask anything according to his will or word, we know that we have. We have the confidence that we have the petitions, plural, that we have asked of him, that we've desired of him. Now, how can I have confidence? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. If I can find it two times in the New Testament, if I can, out of the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word doctrine be established. If I can find it two times in the New Testament, I can stand on that as doctrinal proof. I can have confidence, not in what I feel, but confidence in what God has promised. Faithful is he who promised, who also will do it. Praise God. Hallelujah. Another word for faith in the Greek word is pistis, P-I-S-T-I-S, and it means to be assured or assurance. That you read something, you're so assured in your heart, you're assured that it's true. Now, you can't be assured unless you see it in the Word. But if you can see it in the Word, then you have then assurance in your heart. That's faith. Say, I just believe this. I don't know why my head doesn't understand it, but my heart, I just believe that Jesus died for my sins. You're assured. Why are you assured? Because faith has persuaded you. And that's our third word, is persuaded. Faith, the Word of God, persuades your heart. Your heart persuades your mind. Glory to God. Your mind persuades your body. Hallelujah. This is why with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with his mouth confession is made into salvation. Your head is never going to understand everything of God. Why? Because the Bible says that our carnal mind, our natural mind, is at enmity with God or at war with God. It is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. But our hearts and our spirits can be. Our hearts are subject to God, and our spirit is subject to God because it's born again after his image and after his likeness. Our hearts and our spirits, we read the Word, and actually what the Word of God is, the Word of God is a mirror. When we see that in James, he says that the Word of God is a mirror, and verse 23, for if any be a hearer of the Word and not a doer, he is likened unto a man beholding his natural face in a mirror. So actually what we're doing is we read the Word, we're not reading what we're not, we're reading what we are. We're reading the Word of God, and the Word of God is a mirror showing us this is who we are. We are the righteousness of God, not because of what we've done, but because of what Jesus did and bestowed upon us. When you begin to understand you're the righteousness of God, you'll quit. Sin will start to be diminishing greatly in your life. When you're assured and persuaded who you are, then you'll definitely start walking according to who you are instead of what you're not. I find the righteousness of God that I won't be committing as much unrighteousness, that's for sure. Hallelujah. So be persuaded beyond doubt. Another word for faith is conviction. To where you have read it, you're so persuaded that it's like conviction is like a concrete post. You can't change it. There's things about me you couldn't change if you tried with everything in your might. There's things about me I have such conviction about being born again, saved by grace through faith. I have total conviction about it. You can't put me back under the Ten Commandments, back under the law. I'm totally persuaded. I'm so persuaded in my heart that conviction, the post, have been put into cement. Hallelujah. And it means grounds that you can rely upon. Grounds that you can rely upon, to rely upon. Faith is to rely upon. I rely upon, if I can't see God, then I rely upon what? I rely upon his Word. His Word said it. If he is the Word, and the beginning was the Word, if I don't see the Word, then that doesn't mean I don't have the Word. The Word is Jesus. If I don't see Jesus, I can still have everything Jesus, the person, can do if I'm believing what his Word written in front of me says. Amen. So, that's what faith is, okay? So when we ask in faith, we have to ask with confidence, all right? And where's our confidence come from? It comes from the Word. It comes from finding the promises of God. It comes from assurance. Our heart's been assured or what? Persuaded. So much so that we have a conviction that we can't be changed, okay? And then we have, when it can't be changed and we have that conviction inside of us, then we have grounds that we can rely upon. It's a system that we can rely upon. That truth that is Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We can say the Word is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I am the Lord thy God, and I change not. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. So God says he won't ever change, and he says his Word will never pass away. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my Word will never pass away. I love that. He talks about his Word will never change, and he says he'll never change. Then it says he's the Word, and the Word became flesh. So, I love this. Oh, glory to God. I hope you can capture this. You see, the Word will do everything that the presence of God will do. The presence of God most of the time moves out of sovereignty, but the Word of God moves as you will. Hallelujah. There's many times in my early walk that the Holy Spirit will wake me up to pray. Now I just get up and I just do it nearly as much as I used to. He was establishing something in me. He was drawing me into himself to teach me how to be responsible to get up and now go to him without having to be drawn. Well, I just can't go and pray until I'm drawn by God. No, the Bible says draw near to God, He'll draw near to you. Well, that wasn't my experience. Well, that wasn't my experience either. He drew us unto Himself. No man can come to the Father unless God draw him. But see, God draws you at the beginning, just like He had the burning bush with Moses. We talked about it earlier. But that doesn't mean that he saw Moses talk to God in that bush for the rest of his life. So God will use those early things to draw you to establish something, glory to God, to establish. And you begin to learn about the Word, and the Word of God begins to, and then you start speaking the Word and dry, and you think, oh, what's nothing to it? All of a sudden the life of God begins to come. Amen. Now you're drawing near to God the way He's drawn near to you. You're learning to approach Him and to be bold with boldness, just like He approached you with boldness. Hallelujah. Oh, my glory to God. You're becoming like your Father. Hallelujah. You don't have to always be prompted to do it. You're just mature enough to get up and go. Just like you get up and go to work without your boss calling you. Hey, you coming to work today? You must be working for your parents, if that is, if that's the case. Because most bosses I've worked for, they better not have to make the phone call and ask you where you are. So nothing wavering. What does wavering mean? The word waver means to vacillate. Vacillate, to go backwards and forwards. To vacillate or to overjudge something. To overjudge means you spend too much time being critical in your mind, letting your mind overthrow your heart. Don't allow your mind to overthrow your heart. And when I went to college, you hear the professors say it. They go, usually you want to go with the first, when you take a test, go with your first instinct. They use the word instinct. It's really what your heart, your spirit man. And I can't tell you the times that I've allowed my head to talk my heart out of things. I was taking a test yesterday. I was taking a test online about how much do you know about guns or gun. There's just something about NRA or something, and I thought, well, I'm gonna see how much I know about guns. This is something I picked up a few years ago, and I just wanted to just learn a little bit about it. I wanted to see what my knowledge was, and you take this little self test online, and they were asking questions from the 1900s, and I didn't know some of the questions, and my heart said. Would say, and I did it twice, my heart would say this answer. And my heart, I didn't know, I've never seen it before. I've never seen the information. But my heart still said that's the one. But my head, I started reasoning and started going, well, I think that, let's see, this word usually means this, so I'll try it. And I didn't go with my first instinct, and I was wrong both times. I giggled at myself going, you know, I've been teaching this and doing this. But it's still how often I fall into that, allowing my head to talk my heart out of what it knew. And so, Even though your head only operates with history, things that it's been taught, your heart, the Bible says the Holy Spirit will show you things to come. Even if you've never seen the answer before, sometimes you just know what it is on the inside. And this is when my wife and I met each other. We dated for a while, but you can't see 40 years, 50 years down the road. Now, we've been married 36 years. And you can't, I didn't have the ability to see 36 weeks down the road, 36 days, 36 minutes. You can anticipate, but the Holy Spirit put a witness in my heart. And I dated several girls before, and I really liked them, and I thought they liked me, but it just didn't work out. And they're great girls, and I loved them and enjoyed them very much, and it was good memories in my life. And so I was almost concerned about being able to be married and stay married because, I dated a few girls and went steady and we ended up breaking up every time. So I thought, well, how can I be confident that I'll be able to stay married because either they got tired of me or I got tired of them. And that's just, it happens with most everybody. But it hurts your confidence if you've had failure in the past. And all of the Holy Spirit, when I was driving home, I asked my wife about her testimony. And while she was talking, the Spirit of God dropped in my heart. Never will forget. I could take you to the spot on the road where it happened. And He dropped in my heart, and I knew that night she would be my wife. Now, I didn't know that she would be faithful to me intellectually. My heart received confidence to ask her to marry me. And seeing that God says, till death do you part, I just assumed that God doesn't bring someone into your life for them to walk out on you in 2 or 3 days or 2 or 3 years or two or three decades. And so I just trusted in the Lord. 36 years later, it doesn't mean we're perfect, but 36 years later, the blessing of God is still upon us. Amen. For what God is the Alpha and the Omega, what He sees at the beginning, He sees the end from the beginning. So He looks down 36 years and goes, is she going to be faithful to you for the rest of your life? Therefore, it brings me a confidence to say yes in my today because God gave me the confidence for my tomorrow. Now, I don't see all of my life unfolding and the blessing of God, the fullness of God's blessing in my life yet. But in my heart, I still have that Holy Spirit. Just like I started off my journey with my wife, I have the journey with the Holy Spirit for my life. I know that I'm going to see the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in America. It is my dream. I know I'll be used by God in this outpouring of the Holy Spirit. It's what God has shown me. And sometimes I've seen everything but that come to pass. With that being said, you have to believe what God has told you. And if you begin to waver, look what God says will happen. If you waver, you'll vacillate, you go back and forth, or you overjudge. You allow your heart, you allow your head to talk your heart out of what it believes, all right? So that's what wavering is, allowing your head to talk your heart out of it, usually due to circumstantial evidence, all right? Now, nothing can make you change your mind or your confession. When you're wavering or when you're steadfast and not wavering, it means nothing can make you change your mind or your confession. Now, it doesn't mean you're not going to be tested in it because you're going to be tested for every word of God you say. Have you noticed the Bible says that every word of God is pure? You know why every word of God is pure? Because every word of God's been tested by fire. Jesus was tempted in all manner as we are. Every word of God that comes out of your mouth, you're going to be tested. You're going to be tried. He's going to see whether you've got real gold or fool's gold. He's going to see whether you're just saying that because you heard some faith preacher say it or somebody on TV said it, or you said it because you believe it. Hallelujah. You're going to be tested. Don't you worry. It doesn't matter what church you go to. You're going to be tested. You can't go to church enough. You can't pray enough not to be tested. Amen. Now, your waves. Now, this is what the Holy Spirit showed me. He goes, waves are driven by the wind. Boats are guided by the rudder. Isn't that good? Waves are driven. Boats are directed. Boy, write that down. Winds, I'll say it right here in a minute. Waves are driven by the winds, but boats are directed by the rudder. So the wind comes against the boat. The waves are going this way, but the boat's going that way. So now to get the boat to continue to go, you have to take that rudder and you have to steer it in the direction that you want to go. The Bible in James talks about your tongue is your rudder. It says that you take this small rudder, chapter 3, verse 4, behold also the ships, which though they be so great are driven by fierce winds. Now this is what we're talking about. When you begin to speak the word, and one of the great faith keys is speaking the word. And when you want to speak the word and you begin to speak the word of God, then here comes fierce winds, fierce opposition. Like, man, what's going on? I'm speaking the word and worse things are happening to me. They're happening because they're coming to steal the word that was sown in your heart, Mark chapter 4 says. We talked about this in the last session, that they get out midway in the lake and the Sea of Galilee. And they get out in the midway in the sea, and all of a sudden the storms always begin to happen in the middle. It takes just as much energy to go forward as it does to go backwards. You set sail, and it's every single time you read about them getting in a storm, it was in the middle. It wasn't towards the end, and it wasn't towards the beginning. It was always in the middle where it took just as much energy to go forward or to go backwards as it did to go forward. Isn't that good? Behold, also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned. Oh, glory to God. I tell you, we saw that word but earlier. But let him ask in faith. Now we see that word yet. Yet. No matter how strong the winds are, no matter how much difficulty you are experiencing, he said, take that rudder and turn it. That little rudder, the smallest part of the ship, and turn that ship in the direction you want it to go, and don't allow the adversity and the adverse circumstances to push you around. Glory to God. This is what we're talking about, speaking in the dark. That you speak what you believe, not what you feel. You speak what you believe and what you desire, and not what you're experiencing. Hallelujah. God didn't say, ooh, it's dark out here. God said, let there be light. And he spoke that when it was still pitch black out. He wanted light, not darkness. He didn't observe the darkness. He observed the light that he had in his heart. And he brought the light from the inside because he is light. And he spoke it to the outside. You've got the kingdom of God on the inside. You're speaking things to the outside. The kingdom of God lives within you, but it can create things on the outside of you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Good stuff. My time's almost up, you know. Amen. Now, even so, I got to read this again. Behold also the ships, James 3:4, behold also the ships which though they be so great are driven of fierce winds, and yet they are turned about with a very small helm, wheresoever the governor or the pilot of the ship, wherever he wants to go, because he goes wherever he wants to go, he just turns the rudder where he wants to go. The guy that's in the ship, let me tell you, the ship is your life. Your spirit man is the governor that has, or the pilot of the ship, all right? The captain, the pilot, the guy that's steering it. And he sees the storm. The storm's coming right at him. And instead of turning around and running away from it, he says, I don't want to go away from it. I've told you I'm going to the other side. He takes that rudder, or the same thing we do, we take our tongue, and he points it right to the finish line, right to the heart of the darkness. He learns to direct the thing right through the darkness. He don't run from it. He goes right through it. Hallelujah. Having done all to stand, stand. You don't turn and run. Come on now. Even so, verse 5, even so the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. Isn't that something? It's a little member. It says, just like the tongue is just like the rudder. It's little, but it can turn the whole body. Glory to God. Isn't that good? Psalm 116 verse 10 says, I believed and therefore have I spoken. Now it's interesting, in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 13, Paul quotes the writer of Psalms, Psalm 116. Now it's an Old Testament scripture, but Paul brings it over and the Holy Spirit allows it to become New Testament doctrine. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 13. We believe and therefore speak. Let me quote the whole thing. I believe and therefore I speak. He goes, we also believe, therefore we speak. Now, this is interesting. Paul was quoting the Old Testament, Psalm 116. He says, they believed and they spoke. Paul goes, we, like them, also believed and we spoke. Now, let's go back to Psalm 116, verse 10. I believed and therefore have spoken. I was greatly afflicted. Isn't that interesting? Paul is going to say, well, we believe and therefore we speak. We therefore having the same spirit of faith. We believe and therefore we speak. Well, okay. But what the full psalm said this. I spoke even though I was greatly afflicted, which means I was heading to the shore. A great fierce wind began to come against me and I was faced with great adversity, but I believed and I still spoke no matter what was coming against me, no matter who was giving up on me, no matter who didn't believe in me, I believe and therefore I've spoken even though I was greatly afflicted. Of course you're greatly afflicted, because anybody that sows, oh glory to God, anybody that sows the word of God, the devil's no respect for persons and neither is God. The devil's going to come against you to steal, kill, and destroy, and especially when you put the word of God in your heart and in your mouth. So he comes to ruin. The Bible says he comes immediately. Satan comes immediately, Mark chapter 4, to steal the word that was sown in your heart. You spoke it into your heart, and it was sown into your heart, and that word may have been for your healing, your deliverance, your breakthrough, your marriage, your finances, and that word was sown in your heart, and the devil says, I can't have them having a harvest. I've got to come and steal that seed, because if I let that thing grow, they will be blessed, and people will believe in their God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There's more at stake here than your promise. It's other people's destinies. If you succeed, glory to God, when David succeeded in killing Goliath, all the other Israelis, they all got their swords and began to chase Goliath's brothers and the other Philistines. They shook there for 40 days and 40 nights and not one man made one step of advancement. But when David got through to his victory, all the Israelites began to pick up their swords and they ransacked the enemy. When Gideon's 300 overthrew those thousands and thousands of people, then the people who were weary, they went and got their swords and shields, and they began to go attack. The ones that went home began to come back, and they joined the fight, praise God. When people see you finish your course, it's not just you finishing your course. Your people around you are going to see your faith and they're going to follow your faith. That's why Paul said, follow me even as I follow Christ. People are not going to follow you if you're not a finisher. You just can't be a talker. You got to be a walker. Hallelujah. Time's about up, isn't it? Praise God. Isn't that good? Oh, glory to God. I think we're going to stop right there tonight. I think that's fair enough and good enough. Amen. Father, we love you tonight. Praise God. I hope you've been blessed by this. We're time constrained with this. And we'll just pick it up next time. I hate stopping like that in the middle of something, but we're in a good stopping place, and we'll pick it up next week. Let your light so shine before men that they can see your good works. What is your good works? It's you holding fast to your profession of faith. If people don't believe in what you believe in anymore, maybe you don't want to speak it out loud in front of them. God says, don't cast your pearl before a swine. If they've not believed in your vision, don't be like Joseph and keep telling them how they're all going to bow down to you. But don't let someone steal that word out of your heart either. When you're alone, glory to God. Maybe you're tired of confessing in front of people because they've given up on you. They don't believe in what you believe in. They think you've wasted your life and your time believing in these promises of God. But I've got news for you. Don't cast your pearl before swine. Love them, be good to them, you know, they're, for whatever reason. Don't let them talk you out of it. Don't get bitter towards them. They don't know what they're doing. That's why Jesus said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Just don't get petty, but just release them. And when you get alone, don't you quit believing what you believe. We believe, and therefore have we spoken. And what we spoke, even though I was greatly afflicted, even though we are greatly afflicted, we still speak the word of God. Oh, hallelujah. We're going to talk about next week. We're going to finish speaking in the dark. It's some of the best revelation that God has given me on this subject. And I think you're going to be really blessed that when the Spirit of God is present, we have great boldness. But even when we don't feel him, it's imperative that we still speak that word in the middle of the darkness and right through the darkness. We're going to talk about it next week, God willing. We love you. God loves you. We'll see you next time. Amen.